Hi, and welcome to the ReReview, where we review reviews so you know what reviews to view. I'm Jared.
And I'm David. So this week on the ReReview, we are going to answer last week's mystery review. I know you've all been wondering about that. We're going to give you a new mystery review, and we have our movie review for Blue Juice. But before we get into that, we're going to start with this week's ReReview, which comes from an adult-type store. And here's what Lulu has to say about it in her 2-star review. If the horse mask and gag balls don't scare you, I'm seriously impressed. We came in during a leisurely Sunday stroll, and this store caught our interest. I knew it was an adult store, but it was more fetish than I expected. It had a little bit of everything. Selection of whips, you got it. Looking for BDSM or Halloween costumes? It's waiting for you. Though there's a big chance it's secondhand. And the user before you never washed it. There's a lot, probably too much stuff crammed in this little shop. And depending on the shopper, a lot of it will be pretty damn interesting. And some will border on scary. I like to buy lingerie and whatnot, but this place was definitely not for me. I left empty-handed and so glad for fresh air.
Okay. Oh, okay, wait. Who's scared of a horse mask?
We've all seen those horse masks that people wear and they do goofy things in them. Things you may not expect a horse to do or whatever. I don't think this is one of those.
Okay. So you think... Okay. I guess it could be a little frightening.
I imagine it was more Trojan horse type of thing. A lot more leather and angry looking rivets holding it in place.
Sure. Okay. When I read this review, I immediately pictured, those big goofy horse masks, and it made this review a whole lot easier to swallow.
Well, with those ball gags, I think you'll have trouble swallowing anything. So if those ball gags aren't for you, okay. But here's what really caught my interest with this review. So it sells a lot of this costumes and whatever. Secondhand? How do you...
Yeah.
If you just walk into the store... What about them says somebody definitely used this and it was not washed?
I'm guessing she may have smelled something.
Oh my god. Oh. I mean, were they like, I'll have a confession to make. I've never actually done anything BDSM related. I'm sorry. It's just my life hasn't led me down that road. That said, are there whip marks or something? Yeah, are there high heel, like stiletto heel marks on the leather?
The leather's just slightly stretched. I don't know, man. I couldn't tell you. I think one of her biggest problems with this was going in on a Sunday.
She did go in on a Sunday. Like, that was a lovely mass. Hey, look!
Like, I think it would have been a whole lot, like, easier to handle if it was a Saturday, perhaps, or maybe a Friday. But, like, going in on a Sunday, like, I don't know what you were expecting.
Well, here's the thing. They were just walking along on a leisurely stroll, perhaps just for... Maybe they did just leave mass. Maybe they just went for a walk in the park and fed the ducks. And then they're like, hey... That's creepy little closet-sized place. Because I read other reviews. Apparently the place is quite small and just jam-packed with scary horse mask and gag balls. They saw that and they go, we are going in.
I'm going in.
Yeah, we just did like 17 Hail Marys. We got some sinning to do.
No, I mean, you can't fault the place for being small. I mean, how many places are willing to give a lease to, a BDSM shop?
I honestly have no idea.
how many of them have you seen?
Here's one thing I found interesting. Okay, now, I've got, I do have other confessions to make. While I've never done BDSM, I actually have been to sex shops before. For whatever reason, I'll live my life, you live yours, no judgment. But there was one, and directly across the street from this one was another. Separate owners, but... So what I'm saying is, if you look for them, you will find them. If you're in a larger city, not even that big, but you know, if there's at least a Walmart, you can count on there being a sex shop.
You know, I was just looking the review over again, and I'm pretty sure I was correct with my original assumption. With the "so glad for fresh air" response, she definitely smelled it.
Yeah.
God, I have to give that a, you know, 10 out of gross.
And I'm going to give that a 17 Hail Mary out of center. That's enough of that. It's time for some fresh air, perhaps some...
some fresh... nice ocean air, perhaps?
Yeah.
So this week's movie is Blue Juice. I'm not too sure what to expect from it, but I think this lovely trailer will give us an idea.
Oh, hold on. I gotta get ready. And let's do this.
Beautiful.
Down here and you're more worried about chasing after some bird.
Chloe is not a bird.
Dean, Dean, we're surfers. The word is babe.
Surf's up! But they're mates from London. Chloe, I grew up with them.
You never grew up.
You are wonderful. You're beautiful. One life, no fear.
You've given him shit, haven't you? No, that's a good eat.
You know what marriage is? And I've got no bounds. I was lost, but now I'm found. I believe in you, and I got no bounds, and I'm moving on. You surf the boneyard.
Yeah.
My light shines on. My light shines on. My light shines on.
My light shines on.
I'm getting out of the darkness.
My light shines on.
And my light shines on.
My light shines on.
Said I'm moving on.
I'm speechless. Okay, so here is what you get from Blue Juice by looking at the cover of the movie. You see Catherine Zeta-Jones and somebody who I believe is supposed to be the male lead, Sean Pertwee. However, the image on the cover looks absolutely nothing like him in real life or the film itself. So it's a surfing movie. That's what we know looking at the cover. You wouldn't know that looking at the name of the movie, because I still don't quite know what Blue Juice is.
Yeah.
Perhaps there's anyone who's fluent in United Kingdom English. If you can tell me Blue Juice is a common or... You know, just a nomenclature, just a word you guys use.
I mean,
for the ocean,
they used it multiple times in the movie.
They used it like 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, I think a max of 3. But I can't find it. I even I became obsessed with it while watching the movie because, well, honestly, trying to figure out what blue juice means was more entertaining than watching the movie.
So, okay, here's what this movie is good for. It's if you need to do your taxes or something and you want to have some background noise that will not distract you at all, blue juice.
Yeah, it's very effective.
The most distracting thing about the movie is Catherine Zeta-Jones. Let me just say, Catherine, thank you for appearing in this movie. I appreciate you. If you would like to meet up, you can message us on this website, or you can send us a tweet at @the_ReReviewers on Twitter, and I will get back to you as soon as possible. Big fan, would love to meet you, and you don't need to apologize for being in this movie.
Oh, no, not at all, because you weren't alone in being in this film.
No.
Let's see.
I mean, this movie came out in 1995, and there are some names in this movie. I imagine during that time, you know, what was this? This is over 20 years ago. You guys may have been more unknown. I mean, we have Obi-Wan Kenobi, Ewan McGregor.
Ewan McGregor was in this movie.
He's in this movie. I think he had to, like, between this and Phantom Menace and, 4 years later, he grew a lot as an actor.
I don't know if we have this film, we have this movie to thank for it.
Oh no. I mean, if anything, it got his face out there and they're like, hey, he looks inexpensive. Let's put him in Phantom Menace. I don't know. Like, was this a jumping off point for Ewan McGregor? Did he ride the wave into Star Wars? Honestly, during our preview of this film, while we watched the whole thing, start to finish, I lost count of how many times I said, I don't care. Regardless of context, I could just say, I don't care. And that was, and Jared understood. He knew what I meant by that.
I think every occurrence of that phrase, I'd simply nod. And I know you can't hear me nod, but you felt it.
Okay,
we both felt it.
Now, if we go into the goods and bads of this movie, I think I can sum up the goods really quick. All-star cast. Perhaps not at the time, but every character, every actor in this movie...
has done something else.
They've gone on to do great things.
Gone on to do better things.
Much better things. Like, I think Sean Pertwee, the male protagonist, the main character of this movie, I don't believe he's done a lot that's been like, oh wow, him. He was, or he still is, Alfred in the TV series Gotham. I think he, in that show, he's probably the best part. He's very dynamic, he's very capable. I think he does Alfred incredibly well.
Yeah, he's been doing that for 4 years, it looks like. So yeah,
and he's absolutely terrific. He's absolutely terrific. But that's it. That's a good. They had a great cast. That said, I don't think anyone was made for this movie. Now let's go into the bads. We'll stay on the theme of casting. I mean, Sean Pertwee or JC. JC is supposed to be, I believe, 29 going on 30, because they keep saying almost 30.
Yeah, definitely that age range.
So him and I, when he made this movie and me right now, we're the same age. I'm almost 30. You're right on the brink if you're not there too. Neither one of us look as old as JC in this movie.
I remember asking, how old is everyone supposed to be in this film? Because he looks 40, and everyone else, like, maybe pushing 20s, maybe 30. Like,
Maybe. I mean, that's the thing about it. Like,
JC is old as hell. Dean is getting there.
Yeah, I mean, like, Ewan McGregor or Dean, I mean, I think they were around the same age, but they only talk about how old JC is. So, take that for what it's worth. The only guy we know for a fact is old was, of course, the Shaper.
Oh, yeah. Shape, as they refer to him for a long, long portion of the film.
If anyone who's confused by that, Shaper, or Shape, he is the guy that makes surfboards, and he's like a guru. Like Dalai Lama type of stuff. He's gonna float. If you float, I will give this movie a 10 out of 10. Yes! There it is! Best movie ever!
Yeah, while we're talking about casting and characters, I don't think since Avalanche Sharks we have seen such a horrendous group of people, such an unlikable cast of characters.
Oh, yeah. I mean, okay, the chemistry between JC and Chloe, played by Catherine Zeta-Jones, it was better than we saw in XXX, that's State of the Union. There was more chemistry, but who can't... If you're... Whoever you are, if you're a male lead cast with Catherine Zeta-Jones, you make chemistry. Because it's Catherine Zeta-Jones. This is 95 Catherine Zeta-Jones. You make chemistry. Catherine Zeta-Jones, I would love to meet you. The underscore ReReviewers on Twitter. Hit me up anytime.
Yeah, please. we both have access to that, so, you know.
It will be a double date. By that, which I mean, it'll be me and Jared and you.
Take
your pick.
I just looked up the only other... character that I hadn't seen in any other film. So it turns out not everyone in this movie went on to do bigger, better things, as his most credited role was in Hannah Montana the movie.
Hold on, are you talking about Terry, played by Peter Gunn? Wow. Okay, so we have another character, Terry. He's the comedy relief.
Which we use very loosely.
He is not funny. Maybe he is. Maybe he is a naturally goofy fella. I think he can be goofy. I think he can be funny. I think he can be a light in the moment where you need it.
Or maybe it's all just funny stuff that we don't understand because we don't speak the Queen's Old English.
That's true. We don't speak the Queen's. He wasn't funny. There were attempts. I feel everything that he was meant to do that was supposed to be humorous, he had no part in it. They just told him, do this goofy thing in this scene and people will laugh.
That was just groan worthy.
I mean, there's no excuse for that. He wasn't funny. He was wasted as an actor. I feel like he could have been capable, but then again, looking at his filmography, he's not gone on to do much else. He appears here and there in a TV show and Hannah Montana, the movie. But
I feel bad for this man. I started off not liking him, and now I feel bad for him.
Fun fact, he played another character named Terry in TV miniseries Sunshine from 2008 in one episode. The pilot episode.
Oh, wow. Okay.
That's all I have to say about Terry. He wasn't funny. He didn't add anything. And that kind of segues into my next con about this movie. There's no point to it. You look at the cover and you see surfing. You watch the movie and there's about... I'm going to be generous and say 2 minutes of surfing. And that's to include people on the water on a surfboard.
But not actually surfing because there's no waves.
Whether or not, that's a big point. There's no waves or whatever. But then there are waves because they do these cutaways in between scenes where they show a wave.
With nobody on it.
With nobody on it. And that's another thing about it. It's just like we have these cutaways, these random shots that are supposed to be somewhat related to what we, the viewer, are seeing transitioning between one scene to the next. The cutaways have no reason. There's no purpose to them. And they can be anything from a wave to a setting sun to the shaper making a surfboard, which then goes into another scene completely unrelated to any of that.
Oh, but they link them together with a radio show. I'm guessing like a riff on some local radio show there, but like nothing said in that show makes any sense at all.
Now, we give a lot of guff to exposition in movies. This movie needed more of it, okay? Just because characters are introduced and suddenly they mean something to the story. But they don't. There's all these different stories going on. I mean,
none of them matter. Not one. Yeah.
Like let's try and break down the story for each character. We'll end with JC, but we have JC and his friends. We have Terry, who's engaged. We have Dean, who's kind of a junkie burnout. We have
Josh.
Josh, yeah. Josh.
Oh, wow.
The,
look at that.
The Josh Tambini. Played by Stephen Mackintosh. I'll see what else he's in, but
he was in Snatch.
So each he
I'm
was
sorry,
in Snatch.
Snatch. Lockstock. My apologies.
Oh, Lockstock. He's also in the Underworld movies. He was a Tannis.
Oh, that's
whom
right.
I don't recall. I'd have to watch those movies again, but I'm not going to do that either. Each one of them has their own story, and I get it. You can have a movie where there's different stories going along that are intertwined with the main plot, but they're not. The only one who was kind of mixed in with everyone else was Dean, played by Ewan McGregor, where he has Terry, this kind of, I don't want to say proper, but he's like the only one of that group of friends who's grown up. He's engaged to be married. He owns a pub in London. They literally drug him and steal him away and take him out to this podunk town on the coast of
England. To then drug him again.
They do drug him. They drug him a lot. And they don't tell him. Except when they do tell him, but he's drugged up. But then he's sober and they tell him and he's mad now. But whatever. So there's Terry. He's getting married. He's a pub. He's grown up. They drug him. They steal him. And that's his story arc, is trying to... He just parties a little bit, and he learns that he can have fun, too. They never get back to what happens to his pub. I guess he sold it. They don't mention that again, ever. They mention it a couple times, but it has no meaning.
Maybe he's
much
still,
like everyone's character arc.
Maybe he still owns it. Maybe he's still running it, just not from within the bar. God knows. Like none of it matters. Nothing matters.
It doesn't
not
matter.
One
it,
single
none of,
thing
none of those
matters.
Matters. Now, what was that thing I said several times?
I don't even care.
Exactly. Now, were you saying that to what I was at, like my question, or did you answer? I don't know.
That was the answer. You know, I can't feel anything. I tried to, you know, maybe feel something in regards to any of the characters, and all I felt was, disgust and hatred. It's just unlikable.
And let's see. So that's Terry. He was getting married, and then he didn't want to anymore, but then he got married because movie. Then you had Dean, junkie burnout, gives Terry drugs, and Terry has fun for the first time, I guess, ever in his life. Dean's character arc is sells drugs, gets beat up for selling
bad
weak
drugs. Yeah.
I don't want to say bad drugs. Bad drugs implies death or sickness.
This is true.
He sells weak drugs, except for Terry, who I guess is a lightweight. Doesn't matter. I don't care. and then he gets beat up for selling bad drugs. And then he's like, oh, you got to ride the wave because I sold the store journalist. They don't mention that, but I think it's in there. Doesn't matter. Don't worry. None of this matters. And then he rides a wave later and gets saved by JC. That's Dean. Then we have Josh, who is a apparently very famous DJ in London, who learns that you can't add a techno beat, because this is the 90s after all, to old songs and make them good. And that's his character story. That's his story.
Yeah,
his character arches being himself to learning that you can't do thing to doing thing again, but with the permission of the people that he was sampling their music in his techno.
Yeah, who happens to be Edwin Starr, speaking of famous people in this film.
Could you help me out? Who's Edwin Starr?
You remember that song, War?
Ugh.
Yeah, that
God.
One. Yeah.
Oh, that's
yeah,
him?
He dropped himself low enough to be in this movie.
Oh, you're not talking about Dean, or I'm sorry, Josh. You're talking about the actual artist who
they were stealing the movie. Music from.
Oh, Edwin Starr. Okay, yeah, Edwin Starr. That's the actual person's name. An actual musician, an artist.
Kind of playing himself in there. But
he was just, they just have these people sprinkled into this movie, and that's it. They don't serve a purpose. The story, like, there's no growth. It's okay. The cover says surfing, but the movie itself is a story about growing up, about love, about finding what's important, and no one does any of those things.
Nope. Okay. As much as I want to continue hating on this, because I spent, you know, what, a little under 2 hours just wanting it to end, I think we should give it a rating now.
There's nothing else to say about this movie. Here's the last thing I think we have to say about this movie, and I'm going to ask you, and I feel you'll be able to answer for everyone else. Should you watch this movie?
No.
Yeah. Okay. Like, I hated XXX. I hated
The Exorcism.
Avalanche Sharks. But they were fun. I wouldn't recommend them. I wouldn't watch them again, necessarily. I might actually watch them again, but I don't like them. But they were fun. This movie wasn't fun. And it's about surfing. And partying.
Yeah, which are two things that I've done and do find fun.
Yeah. But just it's not fun. Okay. So, scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate this movie?
I'm going to rate it a Capri Sun out of juice.
Actually, make that a Sunkist, because there's a lot of Sunkist in this movie.
Oh, you know, and Sunkist isn't even close to juice. So, yeah, I got to give it that. That's good. So out of surfing, like, none. Entertainment
2 minutes
factor,
out of an hour and 45.
Entertainment factor, dry sand. Like, it's just a whopping 2.
Okay, on a scale of 1 to 10, I don't care.
I don't think it
gets
more... That
is my rating for this movie. I don't care.
I don't think it gets more succinct than that.
It's not worth a number. It's not worth 0. It's not worth less than 0. It's not worth anything. I don't care. All right, so let's move on from this piece of garbage. So do you have the answer for last week's mystery review?
Okay, yeah. So last week's mystery review, to recap, works like suppose, comes in nice little box. It's actually a little box of magnetic balls that are meant for shaping and designing various objects. So yep. That's it. Of course.
If you didn't guess that.
Of course, they were tiny magnetic balls.
I mean, you didn't even tell me what the review was. You just kind of told me what the mystery review was, and you said, works like suppose, comes in nice little box. And I was like, dude, tiny magnets. Of course.
Of course it is.
All right, so if you guessed that, congratulations. 2 stars. For
yep,
you.
Yep. All right. I drew them yesterday. They're ready. Just
yeah. Well,
just come get
they're
them.
They are in the mail for everyone to guess that. All right. So here's next week's mystery review. Again, if you think you know the answer, hit us up on Twitter at @_ReReviewers. So here's next week's mystery review. Feels like low quality plastic. An opening too big for eggs. Which kind of sinks into the space. A bit disappointing. So I don't think another review is necessary. If you can't guess that from that, shame on you. So that's all we have for you. But stay tuned next week. We have the upcoming review of Bucksville, where in a small wooded town, a young man struggles to leave a secret militia started by his father. And Amazon reviewer Dina Shack gave it a 1-star review with, and I quote, no comment.
Oof.
Yeah, quite frankly, I'm looking forward to this. I like bad movies in the way that you can watch a bad movie with a friend and really enjoy it. Just have fun with the movie.
So hopefully we can do
this
that
will be
with
the fun
this.
Movie.
Yeah, unlike Blue Juice, good lord.
Unlike Blue Juice.
You know, we like bad movies. We like bad movies that can be enjoyed. So we'd appreciate it if you guys would send us ideas for new movies you'd like us to review, or you know, reviews that you'd like reviewed. You can reach us on Twitter at @_ReReviewers. Or you can just send us a message on our website.
And that's all we got for you. Thanks for tuning in. See you next time.